Did you know that the penny was the first coin to bear the face of an American president? That president, of course, is Abraham Lincoln. There are about 130 billion pennies in circulation, and the U.S. Mint produces between 5 and 16 billion pennies every year. However, making a penny has cost more than 1 cent every year since 2006, with current cost estimates around 2 cents. In fact, between the years of 2009 and 2019, the U.S. Mint produced pennies at a total loss of $586 million. In the great penny debate, proponents of getting rid of the penny say the process of making pennies is costly, both financially and environmentally, as the process wastes zinc and copper, two important natural resources. However, penny lovers say that preserving the penny keeps consumer prices down, avoids harming low-income households, and helps raise money for charities. We're talking about pennies on today's episode of GAAP Chats, but not whether they should be discontinued. Instead, we're talking about earnings management and how smoothing your earnings, even if it affects EPS by only a penny, can be considered material and get you into trouble with the SEC. Welcome to GAAP Chats, the podcast dedicated to all things accounting, brought to you by GAAP Dynamics. I'm your host, Mike Walworth, and with me today is Bob Laffler, as Chris is away facilitating a course for one of our clients in Canada. We hope you'll join us on our journey today as we share our passion for accounting and help change the way you train. So, Bob, where do you stand on the great penny debate?
Oh, Mike, it's interesting hearing your little intro there. I must say I feel conflicted by it because my wife is a bit of a penny collector. She's been, collecting pennies ever since, the days with her grandfather and, kind of coming up with these old copper coins. But I must say I am an anti-change person. I no longer want change. I buy everything, electronically with tapping my phone. Like, I think it's time for us to move into the modern age and just kind of get rid of pennies and go from there. If I recall, when I was living in Switzerland, there was no, pennies. It was always rounded up to the nearest, five or whatever. I mean, they've pretty much gotten rid of them.
Well, what's interesting, you brought up Switzerland. That's funny because in Switzerland, they had the 5-franc coins, which at the time that you and I lived there was about $3.50. Yeah. And so do you remember what Jeannie and I did with our change in Switzerland? Do you remember?
Well, you kept it in like a big bucket and then eventually you went on a vacation. Or no, you bought your watches. That was
We saved enough change. We were in Switzerland. Oh, how long were we in Switzerland? Like 4.5 years. And we ended up saving enough for 2 Omega watches.
Yeah. Well, when they've got coins that represent $5, yeah, I can see how you can save money pretty quick.
Yeah, no, exactly. Right. So here's a question. What do you do? So, I mean, inevitably, you're saying you don't have a lot of change. You don't get a lot. You don't pay cash, so you don't get a lot of change.
Well, I never use cash anymore if I don't have to. So I don't have it anymore. But I would say, from the moment we started having kids, we started just putting our change in like a big bucket and I let it grow and grow and grow. And that was my idea, was to actually have a vacation. Mm-hmm. Like, we're going to go on vacation with all our change after, 15 years of collecting coins. We're going to have a big blowout. And finally, trying to purge the house of junk and all that stuff. Finally, the day came, the bucket was getting pretty high. So I decided to take it to the bank and kind of put it in one of those little machines and sort it all out. And I was getting very excited to take a vacation. Mm-hmm. Ends up, it was like, $300 worth of change after 15 years.
Well, and I think there's actually some problems with you, because I have the same thing. I have to admit to you, I have absconded of a company asset, I think. I took one of the empty Diamond Springs water bottles, those 5 gallon sort of thing.
Yeah.
And I took it home, put it in my coat closet downstairs, and I basically just dump all my change in there, and it's totally filled now. And so we were trying to guess how much that is. And again, that's for a vacation. But if it's only like $300, I don't know that's going to last.
Well, that's a bigger bucket than I was collecting it in.
Okay.
But it really all comes down to, is it copper or is it silver that's, in that thing, right? If you got enough quarters, you might be all right. You never know.
But interesting, there was a case recently where there was a lot of change. There was a chain shortage, right? And because, they were asking that. So I think there's probably a lot of us around there, like, around the U.S., like, could just collect this change. And maybe the U.S. Mint, especially if they're losing a penny for every penny they mint, they almost should say, hey, bring in your change. We'll do the rolling for you for free. because that's the pain in the ass right now, right?
That's why some of these banks have the change machines that just kind of like sort it for you. You just dump it in there. It's sorted and off it goes. There's a local credit union that does it.
They do it for free though.
Up to $100 or whatever it is. Like there's a certain dollar amount that they'll let you do each time. And you can only do it like once or twice a month where you can kind of do it for free. But yeah, check for those. Otherwise you get killed with the fees.
Because there's stuff at like the local, you know, Kroger or local grocery store. But they charge you like 10% fee. Anyway, you want to hear something? We'll get on to our topic in a minute. But, you know, I cannot to this day go by or walk by a penny on a ground in a parking lot. Like I will not leave a penny if I see it. And it goes back to, you talked about your wife and her granddad, right? Mm-hmm. And it goes back to my grandma because I remember distinctly when I was a little kid, my grandma would be like, I think I was with her one time and she's like, oh, look, honey, there's a penny in the parking lot. It's on heads. Pick it up. Mm-hmm. And I was like, grandma, it's only a penny. And I think she never got mad at me. I was her favorite. Hopefully my brothers aren't listening to me right now. But anyway, she said, Mike, you never know. That's a blessing, right? You never know when you're going to be, if you're too quote unquote rich to pick up a penny, then God may stop blessing you, you know, or whatever. And so to this day, I am always picking up damn pennies in parking lots. It's even in COVID, I didn't care about the germs, you know, and I just put it in my mouth and no, I'm just kidding.
I'd say that's what caused me to stop picking up pennies is how nasty they generally are. They're all grimy and stuff. But anyway, I guess, shall we get on with the purpose of the podcast, Mike? Let's move on to the topic at hand. What are we going to be talking about today?
We're going to be talking about earnings management.
Okay, so how does earnings management tie into this great penny debate that we've been chatting about?
Well, sometimes companies employ earnings management techniques to ensure they meet earnings targets for the period, and that even a penny move in EPS could draw the ire of the SEC and result in fines and penalties.
I'm intrigued. Why don't you tell us more?
All right. So anyway, I came across a story in the Wall Street Journal in March, where the SEC, as part of its EPS initiative, fined automotive parts manufacturer, or supplier rather, Gentex. They fined them $4 million for alleged earnings management tactics that added just a single penny to its reported EPS.
So that's interesting. But I guess before we find out more about this, you know, manipulation, what exactly is this SEC's EPS initiative that you're talking about?
Well, I'll be honest. I mean, I should have known about it. And I heard something about the SEC using big data and stuff like this, but I really didn't know when this article referenced the EPS initiative. I had no idea what they were talking about. But anyway, the SEC's EPS initiative uses risk-based data analytics to detect potential accounting and disclosure violations caused by earnings management practices. Basically, what the SEC is doing is they're using issuer data to look for patterns where issuers meet or slightly exceed consensus EPS estimates for multiple consecutive quarters. And this is usually followed by a significant drop in EPS in later quarters.
So the classic robbing Peter to pay Paul, make sure that you have just enough until finally you give up and then you just take the loss.
Yeah, exactly. Eventually it all catches up with him. The first mention of this EPS initiative came back in September of 2020. And to date, it has resulted in cases against six companies and several individuals, including five current or former CFOs. So these cases, the six that I referenced, they often include hallmarks of improper earnings management, including unsupported manual adjustments or paper transactions that occur immediately prior to quarter or year end and that have an immediate impact on the company's reported financial results.
So what exactly was the deal with this auto supplier then? What happened in that case?
Well, back in 2015.
2015?
Yeah, I figured
you could. What year are we in, Mike? Are we seriously talking about 2015?
We are recording.
We are recording. This is Hot Topics, everyone.
We are. Shut up. We are recording this podcast. What is today's date? April 24th, 2023. So you're right. It doesn't seem like it's exactly recent news, but the case wasn't settled and made public until February of 2023, and then the Wall Street Journal picked it up in March of 2023. So it, you know, the order settled then.
Like, this is not like our last political podcast where we're talking about, you know, all these lawsuits and, you know, there's no statute of limitations when it comes to the SEC's oversight and reach.
Yeah, well, and I guess the other thing you sort of realize when you bring up 2015 and you laughed at me, you can't really hide from big data, right? Big data is going back. They're using this EPS initiative to kind of go way back in time to see if companies were messing around with earnings. Anyway, at the time, the company's chief accounting officer, who then became their CFO, he's now their CFO, actually, he's still there. He reduced a reserve for paying executive bonuses from $300,000 to $100,000. This change meant that the company met its 27-cent a share earnings target. The SEC noted that the chief accounting officer said in an internal email, had to reduce the reserve in order to keep 27 cents per share, to which the current CFO responded, or the then CFO responded, good call. That puts us in line with consensus, right? To which the CAO replied, yes.
Oh, God. So caught red-handed. I mean, do people not realize that you can't put this kind of stuff in emails by now? But I guess back in 2015, we were still learning.
We're probably under pigeons. It's so long ago, right? Anyway, well, yeah, the SEC order noted. So here's, this is coming directly from that SEC order. During the quarter closing process in the third quarter of 2015, Gentech's then chief accounting officer directed the reduction of an accrual for a performance-based bonus program, resulting in Gentech's reporting EPS that met consensus research analyst estimates. The CAO directed the reduction without performing an analysis of relevant criteria under U.S. GAAP and without documenting the basis for his decision. The order further finds that in multiple additional quarters between 2015 and 2018, this chief accounting officer and other Gentech employees made adjustments to bonus compensation accruals without the required accounting analysis or without adequate supporting documentation. These entries were made possible by Gentech's failure to devise and maintain a sufficient system of internal accounting controls related to its closing process, including its accounting for bonus compensation and failure to maintain internal control over financial reporting.
Okay, so if I recall, before you gave us that rundown, you said that they reduced their bonus compensation from $300,000 down to $100,000. So that's just a $200,000 reduction. That, you know, given the size of these, you know, executive compensation, I mean, that doesn't seem like a ton of money. Why did the SEC have a problem with something this small?
Yeah, well, so let me go back to kind of, you know, maybe I'll go, you know, the Paul Harvey, the rest of the story. Let's dig into the order a little bit. So basically, on October 7th, 2015, the chief accounting officer made an accrual, you're right, Bob, for an executive bonus plan of $300,000, okay? According to the SEC, this journal entry was made prior to the approval by the board of directors and without any supporting documentation. Additionally, the chief accounting officer did not maintain documentation of any purported analysis that is required to be performed pursuant to ASC Topic 450 contingencies concerning the loss contingency associated with his bonus plan. So basically, Topic 450 says, you know, you accrue when what? It's probable and reasonably estimatable. Well, he didn't have the support really to kind of book that in the first place. But then the very next damn day on October 8th, realizing his initial accrual would cause Gentech to miss the consensus EPS estimate of 27 cents a share for the third quarter of 2015, he directed a journal entry to reduce the $300,000 accrual to $100,000. Again, the SEC said this revised accrual was made without any supporting documentation and the CAO did not conduct any analysis that should have been performed under U.S. GAAP. But to answer your question about the size of the company, back in 2015, when the event transpired, Gentech had total assets of $2.1 billion and net income of $318.5 million.
So that's not exactly a small company. I mean, that sounds pretty decent size to me. So $200,000 doesn't seem like it would be material in that case.
Yeah, interesting. I think Gentech would agree with you. According to the Wall Street Journal article, a company spokesman noted that none of the accounting entries involved had any material impact on the company's financial statements.
But they probably don't exactly know the definition of materiality, at least it's applied for this purpose. If they didn't reduce the reserve and consequently meet the consensus EPS, then they must have thought the market would have reacted negatively, and therefore, that's why they would have done it in the first place. Kind of that, where that whole email, that red-handed email that we kind of heard in the beginning, right?
Bingo. And so let's dig into materiality a bit. So according to FASB concept statement number 8, it was recently, you remember we taught this a while back, kind of the changing definition of materiality. So anyway, according to the FASB, information is material if omitting it or misstating it could influence decisions that users make on the basis of the financial information of a specific reporting entity. In other words, materiality is an entity-specific aspect of relevance based on the nature or magnitude or both of the items to which the information relates in the context of an individual entity's financial report. Consequently, the FASB cannot specify a uniform quantitative threshold for materiality or predetermine what could be material in a particular situation. U.S. GAAS has also recently amended their definition of materiality as follows. U.S. GAAS defines it as misstatements, including omissions, are considered to be material if there is a substantial likelihood that individually or in the aggregate, they would influence the judgment made by a reasonable user based on the financial statements.
Annual accounting updates are a necessity for accountants and auditors, but that doesn't mean they have to be mind-numbingly boring. Kick off the new year with our Essential IFRS or U.S. GAAP Update course. Looking for something more tailored to your industry? Did you know we also have industry updates for both IFRS and U.S. GAAP on The Revolution, our online learning platform? You can check out all our e-learning courses available at revolution.gapdynamics.com. That's GAAP with two A's. And while you're there, use the code PODCAST2023. That's PODCAST2023 for 15% off your entire purchase. And get ready to change the way you train.
Okay, so you got us the FASB definition of materiality. We've got the U.S. GAAS or the auditing definition of materiality. There's also an SEC definition, right? What does the SEC say about materiality?
Yeah, well, according to the SEC's chief accountant, in a statement given back in March 2022, our old friend Paul Munter references the Supreme Court, which noted that a fact is material if, and I quote, there is a substantial likelihood that the fact would have been viewed by a reasonable investor as having significantly altered the total mix of information made available. He went on to say that those who assess the materiality of errors, including registrants, auditors, audit committee, and others, should do so through the lens of the reasonable investor. To be consistent with the concept of materiality, this assessment must be objective. A materiality analysis is not a mechanical exercise, nor should it be based solely on a quantitative analysis. Rather, registrants, auditors, and audit committees need to thoroughly and objectively evaluate the total mix of the information. Such an evaluation should take into consideration all relevant facts and circumstances surrounding the error, including both qualitative and quantitative factors to determine whether an error is material to investors.
Okay, so that sounds like good advice in this case right here, obviously, making that earnings management, that EPS target that everyone was expecting is a good thing, whereas if you fall under it, even if it's just by a penny, well, now all of a sudden it's seen as a negative. So it sounds like that's pretty solid advice. Let's put Paul's statement in the notes to the podcast so everybody can look at that if they want to.
Yeah, definitely. And so Gentex messed around with the reserves, which is a classic earnings management technique. Bob, what are some other ways that companies might engage in earnings management?
Well, I guess before we get into this, let's be clear here that earnings management is, you know, managing your earnings isn't necessarily always illegal, right? Sometimes it's perfectly legal. This might be things like reducing or eliminating non-mandatory expenses in the short term if revenues are below expectations, so cutting costs and stuff mm-hmm. like that. If revenue is good, you might increase your spending and your CapEx for marketing, things like that. Maybe even give bonuses and raises. These are all normal ways to say a good year, let's invest, bad year, let's kind of cut down. But then you get into the things that may or may not be completely on the up and up, depending on the reasoning behind them. and the related disclosures, right? What you're telling people in the financial statements. And this might include things like lowering or raising capitalization limits on fixed asset purchases, changing inventory or other valuation methods, like changing your methodologies to get accounting results you want, going from LIFO to FIFO, for example, and then messing around with the assumptions and or inputs of management's estimates, including reserves, such as this case that we just talked about here.
Well, in Gentech's case, it was like it was 2015 to 2018. They were kind of messing around with this bonus accrual up and down. And that's the old classic cookie jar reserves, right? You got to love them. You increase them when times are good and release them when times are bad. And by the way, for our listeners, that's not allowed, right? I mean, remember the SEC had a problem with the support and the documentation and analysis surrounding these reserves required by ASC Topic 450.
I remember back in my my old days of being an auditor, early days, when I first went over to Europe, Mike, I was auditing a client. I will not say which client it was, but it was shocking to me when I was in charge of the consolidation. So I was looking at top side adjustments and kind of making sure what they were. And there was one line item, and this was not under US GAAP. So who knows, maybe it was legal for all we know. But but basically the line item was called CFO reserve. And I remember asking the controller, like, hey, I see this topside adjustment that you book every quarter. It's called CFO reserve. What's that? And they're like, oh, well, that's our reserve that we put on there, depending on, you know, whether we need money or don't need money. That's kind of the CFO's kind of extra cushion that he puts into the, you know, the accounts. I'm like, pretty sure that's not allowed.
Well, yeah, if it's a client I'm thinking about, basically that was probably one of the first GAAP adjustments we made to switch him over to US GAAP, the CFO reserve. But it happens all the time. And so here, this wasn't like erroneously labeled. It looked fine enough, right? It's the bonus reserve. But I think as auditors, you got to be careful of those types of things, you know, increases and decreases, making sure that they can be substantiated, because otherwise clients can use those to manage earnings. I mean, you could use, I mean, we talked about Trump and Clarence Thomas. We talked about uncertain tax positions. Well, that would be another one where companies could monkey around with it, right? To potentially, you know, meet earnings.
Absolutely. And let's face it. I mean, the other thing is, I mean, in our experience, let's not fool ourselves. Every company does it to some extent. The question is, you know, how blatant is it, and how well hidden is it, right? You need to have some kind of justification for it. And there's lots of different ways to justify stuff and so forth. But, you know, there's always the potential of earnings management. And I guess it's the end, you know, age old game of auditor versus company, like trying to identify where those areas are and making sure you get proper documentation and support for any of those estimates that are being taken.
Yeah, well, I mean, you know, you can have the estimates like the reserves. That's just sort of straight up, you know, what the accrual should be. But you can monkey around with just management estimates in general. And, you know, you and I are both banking guys and financial services, you know, sort of investment companies, et cetera. And you can kind of mess around with earnings management there too in regards to estimates and fair valuations. And it reminds me of a story, and we do got to be careful in these. I won't change the names. I just won't say the names to protect the, you know, to protect the guilty in this case. But I remember a person we knew left public accounting and went to become a CFO for a mortgage company, right? And so he was the CFO of a publicly traded mortgage company. And one of the things that they had to do each quarter was value their mortgage servicing rights. Now, Bob, 2 minutes or less, or 30 seconds or less, mortgage servicing rights, what are they?
Mortgage servicing rights is basically a asset or liability, but usually it's an asset account that a lot of times it's a mortgage banker that will have, because basically you get a mortgage servicing rights when you sell a loan. You no longer have the rights to collect hold the cash and interest from a loan, but you still are servicing that loan, meaning you're still the one that, you know, collects that, you know, works out, you know, defaults and late payments and so forth. And basically you get paid a fee for that type of work, right? You get a percentage of the collections as a mortgage servicing revenue. So basically, these are assets that are trying to predict the amount of future cash flows that you're going to earn from these mortgage servicing arrangements.
Okay. And so under GAAP, and I believe this is still the case, after the securitization, a piece of that purchase price of the loan is sort of allocated to the mortgage servicing right. And either, I think this is still the case, you can either sort of take that amount and sort of amortize it down over the life of the servicing, right? Keeping in mind impairment, because that's important, right? If it ever gets impaired. Or I believe, and probably under, you know, when we had the fair value option, you could probably fair value these things as well, right?
Yep. Yeah. Even before the fair value option, that was a accounting model.
Okay.
Fair value.
So you could do either. And I forget what this company was doing, but they were valuing mortgage servicing rights. Now, one of the main inputs in this mortgage servicing right or the valuation was really the prepayment speed of the underlying mortgage. Because if the mortgage is prepaid quicker, then that mortgage asset would come down quicker and it might be impaired or whatever. And if they would prepay less, then the asset would stay on the books because it's expected you're going to service it for longer. And so really what this guy and this company was doing was they were messing around with the prepayment speed of the MSRs to meet earnings or not. And here's where the auditors fell down. And this is why whenever I teach mortgage servicing rights and also when I teach the auditing, I sort of say you need to know the assumptions and the inputs that go into any valuation model and understand the sensitivity. Where this big four firm kind of fell down was they came in and they say, hey, a prepayment speed, here's the high end and here's the low end for this quarter of what it should be, right? And of course, this guy and this company always was within the reasonable range. But what they ended up doing was this. You know, the CEO would come in and say, hey, you, how are we doing for earnings this month? And he'd be like, oh, boss, I think we're going to be a penny short. And he would say, slow down the prepayment speed. Oh, boss, I think we're going to be, we've exceeded it by two pennies. Increase the prepayment speed. So they were basically driving the prepayment speeds, the prepayment input on that MSR. They were driving it like a damn stick shift and using it to manage earnings. And so, and this auditor didn't really notice it because it was always within that range, which is why when we teach it, Bob, whenever we teach fair value, we're sort of saying, hey, not only does it need to be in the reasonable range, but you need to see whether it's, you know, is one quarter it's in the middle, one quarter it's at the lower end, one quarter it's at the higher end. It's very, very important. Now, another thing I like to say and use this when I teach this, is that, you know, there is, when you sort of understand the entity, you know, it's important to understand the tone at the top and understand management's, you know, incentives or whatever. I don't know if this is the case, but both the CEO and the CFO were divorced. And both of them basically had alimony payments, and a lot of their compensation was tied up in stock comp. And so it was in their best interest to actually make sure that they met analyst expectations so they could continue paying their ex-wives. So
I guess this is kind of getting us then to that third category of earnings management, which could be just outright fraud. So failing to write down overvalued assets, hiding incurred expenses, you know, pumping up revenues. Obviously, these almost get us into this no longer like, hey, you know, I'm trying to do the best I can here. Oh, it just so happens I'm making my forecast versus, you know, truly just committing fraud. And then there's a fine line, right, between all of these.
Yeah. And that's why in accordance with auditing standards, you know, we're getting into auditing a lot more. We're putting out a auditing e-learning library later this month, actually, will start to come out. Not this month because it's April, but in May. But that's why when you're looking at in your auditing revenue, you always need to consider fraud. I mean, that's when you're talking about revenue accounts. So,
absolutely.
I think we need another podcast, Bob, on like these other earnings management techniques. I think we could kind of get into cookie jar reserves and, you know, the revenue games that companies play, et cetera, et cetera. So we could go a totally illegal, you know, the illegal types of earnings management. So,
okay. Dirty accounting.
Yeah. Sounds Why don't you like take us out?
All right. That's all for this episode of GAAP Chats, your source for all things accounting. Notes and resources from today's episode are linked in the description. And as always, you can find us online at gapdynamics.com and at gapdynamics across social media. It's never too late to become a Gapologist. Head over to our website and subscribe to our blog so that you're the first to know what's new with GAAP Dynamics.